Welcome to Words of Aloha with Pastor Isy Manzo of Amazing Grace Ministries International. We're headquartered in Kailua-Kona on the Big Island of Hawaii. Join us now as we get into God's Word.
Lord, we thank you for this beautiful day. We thank you for this beauty all around us, Lord, that you created. And Lord, you created also your Word. And as we open your Word this morning, we pray that you would prepare our hearts and our minds, our souls and our spirits to receive what you have for us. We pray that you'd use Pastor Isy now to speak to us, to encourage us, to be ready for this coming week. Lord, there's so much that we're thankful for, Lord, and we have you to thank for it. So we ask you to bless our time now in Jesus' name. And all God's people said,
Amen. Amen. All right, guys, well, would you grab your Bibles and turn to Romans 6? We're going to pick up where we left off last week. We got to verse 11 last week, where we were talking about when you're baptized into Jesus, that you join him in two things. Remember what they are? The first thing is, remember, the water of baptism is like a watery, what, a symbolic grave. So you get buried, and so you join him in his death symbolically. And then as we pull you out of the water, that's to representing joining him in the newness of life, that life after death. You say, what's the big deal about that? There are so many people that I find in the Christian, you know, I'll just use the term Christian as in broad sense. Everyone who hears about Jesus, went to church at some point, that don't understand that this thing has great power for our lives to help us be free from the past, from sin, from troubles that have held us back. You know, how many of you know folks that they're trapped in their past? Somebody hurt them or something happened to them, and you talk to them and you find out they're not really living in the present. They're stuck in their past. They're stuck in something that happened to them, and they're not enjoying life. I mean, you tell them, hey, you know, let's go to the beach. Let's go have some, you know, we'll go hang out today. And they're like, man, I can't. You're like, why? Well, this person hurt me. And it sounds like at first you might think it just happened, like that day. Then you find out it was 15 years ago, and they've been staying in their room for 15 years because they just can't get over it. And this is a problem in our society that we have. I mean, we have so many people that are not enjoying life. Jesus said, I came to give you life, and to give it to you what? More abundantly. Now, abundant life in Christ is one of the most beautiful things that I find is offered to us in this walk of faith that we have. I mean, we get to have a freedom from the things that have harmed us in the past, a letting go. We get a point where God says, let me meet you, and let me meet you in this world, what you live in this timeline. Let me meet you and let me help you start afresh. And that's what baptism really affords us. You know, in the early preaching of the gospel, it was understood that all preachers would preach, repent, like John the Baptist. Repent and be what? Baptized. Why? Why be baptized? He said, prepare ye the way of the Lord. The Lord's coming. Get ready for his coming. Get your heart ready. And the waters of baptism, that was John's baptism. It was called the baptism of repenting or turning away from your sin. But then after that baptism came a second baptism, the one that Jesus, when he, you know, the people started to come to him and to his disciples and be baptized into Christ. See, there was ones that were baptized into John's baptism. They hadn't even heard about the baptism of Jesus. And when we read in the book of Acts, when Apollos and Priscilla, Aquila were over there, they said, you know, what were you guys baptizing? They said, John's baptism. He said, get ready for the Lord. The Lord's coming. And these guys said, excuse me, let me pull you aside. He already came. They didn't, you know, we didn't have CNN back then. So it hadn't got over to that region that Christ had already come, and he had already died and been resurrected. And now they were told, hey, you can be baptized into him, into Christ. And this is where what we're reading about today in Romans 6, where we find that there is a huge power offered to us. The power of Christ himself living in us to make us have a whole new life, abundant life. But you can't have abundant life if you don't, like, know about this. What if you never heard about this? What if you didn't know that the scripture teaches that you get to join yourself to Jesus in the water of baptism? You join him in that likeness of his death. You die. And see, the we saw last week, what's the big advantage of us dying with him? What does it do for me as a believer if I can? Now, remember, it says you have to use your mind. The look at verse 11. It says, even so, consider yourselves to be dead to what? To sin. This word in the Greek, consider, means it's to use your mind to think through in a way that what was considered, we say consider, but it's a term what they use when the Greek scholars would go to school, advanced school, like we would say college to get your master's degree, where you really are. The Greeks were very intellectual thinkers. They broke things down into, there's things of the physical passions, there's the things of the emotional things of the heart, there's the physical side, the that part of our dimension of our being, there's our spiritual part. They broke everything, they thought it through. But in their thinking this through, it's very interesting. They said, Paul used the very word, what they would say, you need to consider, you need to think this one through, like serious thought, not just passing over, or I thought about it in passing. No, he means you got to get your master's degree in this. In other words, this is not something we should just go, let's skip over this. Doesn't probably mean anything. No, this is one of those things, just by the literal choice of words, what Paul chose to write this, he is saying, this is one of the things you need your master's degree in your Christian experience. You need to know this up here. Now, someone heard me preach last week and said, wow, you actually include the mind, you know, like psychology, thinking. And I'm like, doesn't it say love the Lord your God with all your heart, your, what's the second thing? Mind, your soul, and your strength, right? Your whole being, love him with all of you. I think that's included. I'm not inviting you to hear what I have to say today and turn off your brain. I'm inviting you to turn it on, because this part will free you. And if you've been stuck, if you've been hurt, and you've never been able to get to go past it, you're going to love what it teaches from this thought. But you've got to start with this. You have to use your mind to consider. Now, if you've been baptized into Christ, I get to tell you, guess what? You joined him in the likeness of his death. When you got laid in that water baptism, you were buried. And then when you were pulled up, you were joined to him in the likeness of his resurrection. So now it says you've been, what's it say? Even so, now consider yourself to be dead to sin, but what's it say? Alive to God. And so last week I ended the sermon with telling you the story about how when it comes to sin, sometimes we just need to, I called it assuming the position of my uncle that was in the grave. Well, he was in the casket with the rosary laying there. And that was my assuming the position of I'm dead to sin. Whenever sin, and by the way, does sin ever cross our path? Any temptation ever hit you this week, you know? When it comes, we have a power to deal with it, what I never had before I was a Christian. Because when sin used to visit my door, when before I knew Christ, I just opened the door. I mean, oh, wow, check this one out. You know, and some of the sins I already knew, just, oh, you're back. Some of them I was like, oh, new one, let's try that, you know? I mean, and I mentioned last week that the scripture says that sin is pleasurable. It says in the King James, there's the pleasures of sin for a what? Season. That's right, in Hebrews it tells us that. And Christ, it said, did not walk in that. Even though it's there, he didn't do it. Now, how do I not do it? That's the real key, because, you know, he already overcame it. But he says, you follow me, and I'm going to be with you, and I'm going to show you how to overcome this. But the way to overcome sin, when it comes knocking at your door, is to remember, I'm dead to that. I died with Christ. I mean, I joined him, so I'm now dead. Sin shows up. If I'm dead, it doesn't matter if I have a short fuse. Because once I'm dead, you can't get under my skin. Now, I use that as a personal example, because some people, when I was younger, they just... they found out I like to fight, and they just, for some reason, you know, once they know that about you, and they know that you, that you're Italian, and you have a little bit of a short temper, and they like to pick at you. Let's just see if we could get him to, like lighting a firework, you know, let's just make him pop, you know, let's see what we can do to get under. And people would do that to me, and I had to accommodate them. Poof, you know, like, I didn't like it. And the problem is that that really wasn't very Christ-like. And when I came to know that Christ loved me enough to die for me, he says, now you come follow me. Join me. I'm like, okay. And those same people, I don't know if they just multiplied after I became a Christian or what, but there was more of them. And they started seemingly like daily getting in my face. I had to learn this Romans 6 chapter really well. Because when they showed up, God said, you're joined to my son. You're now dead to that. Dead to sin. Alive to me, but dead to that. And they'd start getting in my face. And boy, it didn't, how many of you know what I mean by a personal space bubble? You know, like at least an arm length was good. You should probably stay a full leg length away. I did Taekwondo. It's better if you're full, you know, six feet away is safe for you. But any closer, you're in my space bubble. And when people would get in that bubble, I was like, oh, you're too close. Move back. You know, and why is it that the people that are the real creeps like to not, they like to invade? Does anyone know what I'm talking about? Those guys that invade your personal space bubble. They get right up here. And you're like, you're too close. We call that fighting in the phone booth, you know. You're gonna get hurt. You're too close. But when that happens, and I'm supposed to be dead to sin, am I supposed to punch them out? No. So this is where I consider, with my mind, I'm joined Jesus. I am dead to sin. They can get in my face now, and I just cross my arms. Pretend my imaginary rosary's there, you know, like my uncle. Dead to sin, dead to sin. And you know what? You might laugh at me, but this really works. This really, when I consider that I died to sin, I no longer have to have it master me. It's freeing. I know this might sound odd to you, but it is so freeing to actually not go there. You know, some people, they don't realize Christ has made it where we have a choice. A choice to say no to that and just go, I died to that. But now that I'm considered I died to sin, I now can respond in a new way. I can now go, God, I'm alive to you. How would you like me to deal with this person? They're in my space bubble. And he goes, give them a hug. You talk about a change. When you're used to fighting and the Lord says, just hug him. I'm talking about hug the unhuggables. I mean, the unlovelies, the ones you don't want to hug. Goes, that's what I would do. See, now, I can't do that if I don't consider that I died to sin. I died to my own prejudice. I died to my own ways, but I'm now alive to God. I get to now live a life that is new, alive to God, full of his life, full of his love. What a difference it makes on how you treat people. And you know, some of the very ones what I know for certain I would have gotten a fight with, Christ has turned from enemies into great friends. Because he had to change me to let that love go through me and touch them. And then I found out, it was a whole different response on their side. See, I didn't realize how much I was contributing to the problem. What vibe was I giving off when I said, get out of my bubble? You know, when your hair bristles up on the back of your neck and you're like, urgh. Can people feel that? Oh, yeah. They're like, this guy is looking for a fight. But now, I'm dead to that. I've considered myself dead to sin, but alive to God. This is where new life begins. Once you died, what happens to all the mistakes of your past? They're gone. Can you be prosecuted for any of your indiscretions? When you know, maybe you were you broke the law a couple times. You sped on the way to work. We're not going to go heavy here. There's a little speeding. And you die. Can they prosecute you for speeding? No, you're dead. Once you're dead, it's washed away. I mean, it's like erase the slate. It's just, dude's dead. You can't prosecute the guy after he's dead. I mean, he murdered someone. He's already dead. I mean, can't really do the death sentence on the guy. He's already dead. Now, I say this to you because this is what frees my mind to move forward. This is where God says, let me take your past and bury it. Now we can start living. Because until you have that past buried, how do we try to live in the present? We're always dragging that with us, and it's holding us back, and we're not going forward. Now, Paul just got done teaching this so that he could say the very next thing he says in Romans chapter 6, verse 12. He says, therefore, remember, every time a therefore is there, what's it there for? Was there to add to what we just studied. We're going to therefore add to this that we not let sin reign in our mortal bodies so that we would obey sin's lusts. You know, it's like we don't have to go there anymore. And he says, and do not go on presenting the members of your body to sin as instruments of unrighteousness, but present yourselves to God as those that are alive from the dead. Now I get the privilege of choosing to whom do I present myself. You know, whether you realize it or not, we present ourselves every day to something that becomes our master. You might wake up in the morning and present yourself to, you know, let's say you're like some of my family members were heavy into drinking. First thing they did after that, I mean, sometimes their feet didn't even hit the floor. They were already had a beer on the nightstand because they were hungover. I had one stepbrother that used to put a beer on the nightstand when he came in from partying. He always saved one beer. So he could put it on his nightstand, and he put 4 aspirin on it. And he put it on it, and it would get warm during the night, you know. But this was his secret to, not that I don't know if you should teach this in a sermon, but he'd get hammered, and then he would set an alarm for 4 a.m. And in the middle of the night, it would wake him, and he would take the aspirin, drink the beer, and then go back to sleep for a couple hours. He got up around 5:30. And this way, it had not enough time to completely wear off, but enough to keep, like, gradual down his alcoholic level. As I mean, I'm talking, this guy's a hardcore drinker. He would hit my brother Rick. He used to do this every night. That was his routine. So that he'd wake up just with enough to not be completely, you know, hit the bottom of the swing, you know. And he would do that, and I would go, so what's he do to present, what's he presenting himself to? Before he even get, I mean, this guy, before he even woke completely up to get going, was presenting himself to that altar of alcohol. He just said, I got to have another drink. And he did this constantly. Whatever you present yourself to, well, whether you realize it or not, that's what becomes your master. That's what's going to rule you. You might present yourself to a different sin. You could pick, doesn't matter which one, you know, people have different preferences. It could be pornography. It could be, you know, they've got to go see, look at the thing. And whatever it is, he says, listen, you don't have to let sin reign in your mortal body. You have a choice. And this is what I want to point out today. In the end of Romans 6 really can be summed up in this portion, what he's going to describe right here. That you choose who do you present yourself to. Do you present yourself to sin? If you do, to obey its lusts, well then, listen to what he's going to explain what happens. If you want to present yourself to sin, Paul doesn't pull any punches. He calls it like it is. If you continually present yourself to hardcore drinking, what will it do to your liver? What will it do to your skin? What will it do to you, the color of your eyes, the white part? They'll go yellow, right? Get jaundice. The fingernails. I only can tell you this stuff from personal exposure to some hardcore drinkers. Their fingernails start to turn yellowish from the part down, like close to the, you know, where it touches the, what's that part, that little half moon thing, the cuticle thing? Is that what it is? That little part there, that starts to yellow. That means you're having internal issues. Now, I had so many family members, they didn't even notice that they all were yellowing. Except that they would come up to me and go, your eyes are really bright. And I didn't drink. And you're going to laugh. I've never been drunk. And the reason isn't because of any spiritual reason. It's because of all the alcoholics I grew up with. They made me have enough reason to not go there that I just decided, you know what? I don't need to go there. Because they become really, if you've been around some hardcore drinkers, you know that sometimes that drinking can bring out some stupidity that is not desirable at all. And I unfortunately saw too much of it. I saw so much of it, I was like, I'll pass. No religious thing, nothing. I decided this before I ever became a Christian. I'm just not going there. Pick a different sin, one that doesn't do that. I mean, this brings a bunch of problems. And it's funny that, you know, over the course of our lives, with our mind, we do analyze different sins. We sort them out. Well, I like this one better because it doesn't do that, or no one knows about this, or maybe they won't be able to tell I'm doing that. You know, we like to pick ones they don't. We think that they don't know. Problem is that the Bible's going to tell us right here the truth. The wages of sin, at the end of this chapter, look at the last verse. What's it say in verse 22? 23, the wages of sin is what? Death. But the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. It doesn't matter what sin you what sin you partake in. It's kind of like pick your poison. Once you pick the poison and you keep drinking it, eventually it's going to kill you. And we have so many different varieties of sin to choose from. But they all lead to the same problem. They'll kill you. And we like to go, oh, not me. Have you ever met someone that's an alcoholic says, it's not bothering me. It's not doing nothing bad to me. And you look at what's happening to their body, and you're like, you sin is blinding. I am convinced of this for certain, that the more that you get into a certain sin, the more blind you become to its, what is it? You become desensitized, like you don't even notice what it's doing to you. Blinding. It's like cataracts. They grow slowly and they block out your vision. Pretty soon you're so cloudy you can't see a thing. And you didn't even know that it's like that's what sin is doing to our spiritual eyes. We slowly become blinded. Well, Paul gives the answer, the antidote, the real solution. And this is one, guys, if you could share this with anyone you know is struggling, wanting to get past those things. Share with them what Paul shares right here in Romans 6. He says, don't present yourself, the members of your body, to sin. Don't present those members. You're presenting parts of your body to different sins. He says, and when you do, it leads you to, your body becomes an instrument of unrighteousness. He said, but instead, here's what you should do. Present yourself alive from the dead to who? To God. Say, God, here I am. Use me. Any of you ever do that in your prayer time? God, here I am today. Just use my life. Somehow, use me how you want. That's one of the most spiritual things you can do, by the way. Truly spiritual. When we get to Romans 12, I'll show you this is the actual verse I teach as Worship 101. If you want to be on my worship team, we have our newest member, Vita, here. She's joining us. This is the verse I make the worship team members learn. In Romans 12, it's going to be a long time until I get there, so I can preview for you. Maybe by then you'll have forgotten all about it. It'll seem all new on that day. But it says here, therefore, I urge you, by the mercies of God, to present your body as a living and holy sacrifice acceptable to God, which is your spiritual service of what? Of worship. The very thing that if you really say, I want to worship God, well then, it's not how great a singer you are. It's not. It's not how many times you go to church. It's not any of, you know, did you go on missions? Did you teach Sunday school? That's not our spiritual service of worship. True worship to God is saying, God, here's my body. I present it to you. I present myself a living and holy sacrifice. Now, what's holy mean? It means separated, right. Set apart for without sin use. You know, for the use what you would have me do, not in sin, but in your purposes. Here I am. When you say, God, here I am, just use me. Any of you ever thought that in your prayer time? God, I wish you'd just use me. That is the most spiritual prayer you could pray of worship. True worship is just presenting yourself to God, saying, here I am. I present myself to you, not to do a life of sin, but to do whatever you want. I'm a sacrifice for you. However you want to spend me, Lord, however you want to use me, whoever's life you want to touch with my life, I'm yours. And this is what I call worship 101. If you want to be on the worship team, you have to do this. What good is it if the worship team's up here singing a great song, but we're not actually presenting ourselves to God? And we're saying, everybody else, present yourself to God. That's true worship. But we're not doing it. We're just up here jamming, doing a great, you know, let's do three-part harmony, four-part. Go ahead, let's do, you know. And we're not even thinking about, here I am, God, use me. That's not worship. That's why when people ask me, can I sing with you? I says, are you willing to present yourself to God? Are you willing to say, God, here I am, use me? Because really, that's what he requires. Someone who just presents themselves as a living sacrifice. Now, back to Romans 6, we get a choice. Do we present ourselves to sin today, or are we presenting ourselves to God? Who are you presenting? Who would you present yourself to this week? Every day when you woke up, you say, here I am, Lord. Let's go. Use me how you want. Or did you do like my standard MO before I was a Christian? I mean, I don't want to really confess this, but, you know, I never really thought that I was presenting myself to sin. I didn't think of it in those terms, but I was doing that. In fact, I was waking up on my bed thinking about different sins, and, I didn't go, hey, should I not sin today? It was like, I think I'll do this sin and that sin and this sin, and I'm going to punch that guy out and do that. And, you know, we plot our sins sometimes, don't we? Even on our bed. When we're falling asleep, tomorrow I'm going to get even with that person, or I'm going to do this, or I'm going to get back at that. We're kind of pros at figuring out our sin. We put a lot of mental energy into the areas of sin, what we like. But see, Paul is saying, quit presenting yourself to sin. And let me show you what he says. I love how he says this part. This is beautiful. He says, don't present yourself to sin. Present yourself alive to God from the dead. And your members, present them as instruments of righteousness to God. Say, God, use my body for the right things. Instead of punching that guy, use me to hug that person and let them know that you love them and care about them. Or let me be used to give them something they need that will bless them and let them know your love. He says, for sin shall not be master over you. For you're not under the law anymore. You're under what?
Grace.
He says, what then, verse 15, shall we say? That shall we sin, he says, because we're not under the law, but under grace? He said, God forbid. May it never be. Don't go there. He says, do you not know that when you present yourself to someone as a slave of obedience, he says, your slaves are the one whom you obey, either of sin resulting in death or obedience resulting in righteousness. Whichever one you pick, this is the outcome. Boiled down, bottom line, present yourself to sin, you get a result of death. You might not see it right away. Maybe you sin against a person and they put up with you for a little while, but eventually that sin can kill a relationship, can it? If we keep sinning against maybe our spouse, and they took me for better or worse, and too bad, you know, and we keep doing worse. How many marriages have been killed by that attitude? It says you present yourself to, this is the outcome. Sin results in death. Obedience results in righteousness. But thanks be to God that though you were slaves of sin, Paul says to these brothers at Rome, I hope we fall into the same group, that though we were slaves of sin, we have become obedient from the heart to that form of teaching to which he says you were committed. And you, having been freed from sin, now you've become slaves of righteousness. He says, and this is the part I love, verse 19. He says, I'm speaking in human terms because of the weakness of your flesh. But just as you presented your members as slaves to impurity and to lawlessness, and that resulted in further lawlessness. You know, in other words, we were practiced at doing our sin, weren't we? You did some lawless things, and that led to further law. Have we ever spiraled down? This is what he's describing, that sin, you know, ride down the toilet drain. We present ourselves to lawlessness, and then that gets us down a little further lawlessness, and now we're really going down. He says, so now, we did that a lot. He says, but so now, instead of doing that, present your members as slaves to righteousness, resulting in sanctification. Sanctification, that separated place of holiness that God chooses to put, to that unique thing that God says, if you'll just do what's right, I'm going to make you sanctified. He says, for you were slaves of sin, but he says, when you were, look at verse 20. When you were slaves of sin, he says, you were free in regards to righteousness. In other words, you were really good at sinning. You weren't practicing righteousness, were you? He says, so therefore, what benefit do you now derive from the things of which you're ashamed? He says, for the outcome of those things is death. But now having been freed from sin, and now we're enslaved to God, he says, you get to derive your benefit resulting in sanctification. And the outcome of sanctification, that separated place that God calls us to be, separated from the worldly ways of this world and living a life unto him. He says, what's the result of sanctification? He says, it's eternal life. That's the outcome. You get everlasting life. Is that worth it? Is living a life separated from the worldly ways worth it? Does it pay in the eternal scope? Yeah. Big, big dividends. Now, I love this. He says, look, when you were sinning, you were free in regards to righteousness. I'm going to boil it down. So now that you're a Christian and you're supposed to be living sanctified, should we be free in regards to sin? I mean, we didn't practice righteousness when we were busy sinning. Now we're supposed to be serving the Lord, right? So we're supposed to be living this new life, holy to God. Why should I live holy to God a little and then dabble over here in sin? Have any of you run into Christians? I call them the most miserables. They're Christians, but they're the most miserable Christians I know. They're the ones that try to live one foot in the world and the other foot after God. You know, that straddle the fence. Problem for us guys is we don't straddle good on fences. God didn't make us for that. And he says, don't do that. You know, and it's a miserable life. But see, Paul says, look, when you're over on this side of the fence sinning, you were free from doing the right side of the fence, right? You didn't do that stuff. You stayed over here sinning. Now you're called to live over here, the spot where you walk rightly with God, doing the right thing, sanctified life. Why are you trying to put a toe over here? Does anybody know what I'm talking about? Christians that they're like, I'm holy on Sunday, but the other part of the week I'm back over here. Or I'm like this, you know? And some are like, and they're like, oh. And they're the miserables. Because we're not designed for living with one foot in the world and one foot in God's kingdom. We're called to go over here. He says, you are free from righteousness when you were on this side. Now you're on this side. Should we be free from sin? See, if you really want to go forward in life, you got to understand it's time to step onto this side, both feet. You got to live the sanctified life free from the sin, so you can move forward. See, because life is meant to go on. And when you keep straddling the fence, you're running into lumber. It's keeping you from going forward. And that's not what we're called to do. You are called to enjoy life. Free from that junk, because that junk is just, that's just bringing death. That's not life. There is no life in sin. It's not going to bring life. It will bring death. It'll kill your relationship. It'll kill your marriage. Doesn't matter. Unfortunately, with our social media and all the electronics today, pornography is so, in your face. It's so available. You can't even Google something. And I'm Googling something. It has nothing to do with pornography. I'm like Googling about a boat catamaran, and all of a sudden on the sidebar is like pictures that the best I can say is it's the soft porn. This is supposed to be YouTube, and I'm like, it's in your face. And we have to choose. Am I going to live in that, or am I dead to that? See, I just go, I'm dead. Dead to that, because I've seen, how fast can pornography ruin a marriage? But I know that, Pastor, don't talk about this stuff. You're making me uncomfortable. If I make you uncomfortable for a few minutes, but I save your marriage, it's worth it. Because it's really hard for the guy to win back the affections of his wife when she feels like she's being cheated on by some video or some thing. Is it happening today? Is it in the people's faces so much? And the problem is that we have to learn that we died. With our mind, I have to consider, I died to that. So I can now live to God. That thing you're looking at on the screen, that's a bunch of pixels. Let's just get real here. It's not even a real person on the screen. It might be a picture of a person, but it's just a picture created by a bunch of little pixels on this screen. And you're getting all excited and ruining your marriage over that? It's not worth it. Don't go there. God put women in beautiful packages in real flesh. But they're meant to be loved and nourished and cherished and not drooled over on a picture. They need real affection. Someone to really care about them and to treat them the way Christ treats his church. Amen. And that's what real relationship can blossom. That stuff is just an illusion. It's fake. It's fake. Call it what it is. It's really fake. But Pastor, the girl on the thing, she had, this guy's telling me, she had the bedroom eyes. She just looks like she just wants me. And I'm like, dude, they're paying her money. They took like 5,000 shots, and they finally found one that looked like that and put that one in the magazine. I know this because my best friend's dad was an editor for Playboy growing up. And I got to meet the girls that were in the magazine. And let me tell you, they do not look. I don't want to pop your bubble, guys, but they do not look. When you get to run around the house, play with your best friend, and in comes and out goes the Playboy bunnies. And my best friend, his mom was in the magazine, okay? Just so you know, I'm telling you, Troy's mom was one of the Playboy bunnies. And I saw her in her bathrobe in the morning when we had sleepovers. And she does not look like she did in the December issue. At all. There was no mole here. The scar that was on her leg is not there in the picture. How did they do that? Back then, they actually had what they called touch-up. What they actually had an artist, his whole job. They blew the picture up to this frame that was this big, and he sat there and painted over the thing. Then they reshot the photo. It's a picture of a picture that has been touched up. This was before Photoshop and all the electronic ways they do this. They did this by hand. And I saw those girls, and I saw girls devastated because they didn't feel worthy or good looking enough, or they tortured themselves, they starved themselves because they, oh, I'm too fat for the, and the camera adds pounds, that's what they said. So these girls would starve themselves down so that on the picture they would just look what we call normal sized. But they were really twigs in real life. And they didn't look healthy either. It's so weird to think, you know, they had to put all this makeup on them to change the color because their face actually didn't look that good. From the eating and throwing up and eating and throwing. A lot of those girls had that problem. I forget what they call it. Bulimia? Is that it?
Bulimia.
Yeah. And they had such bad self-image. They just didn't feel like anyone really, you know, they were always trying to gain the approval of someone. And I just thought, God already approves. He loves you so much, he sent his son to die for you. And no matter what any man says down here, God's opinion trumps them. He's the boss. Don't worry about it. And the right person for that girl is not going to care either. Because he's going to love her the way God put that love in his heart, to love like Christ loves. You know, Christ accepts us the way we are. He doesn't say, hey, when you get all skinny and a perfect body, then you're accepted into my club. How many girls do you know that got messed up because someone kept saying to them, well, if you just lose a few pounds, then you'd be acceptable. Then you'd be in the better social, you know, club. That is baloney. God loves every one of us, and he made us unique, and he designed us different. You know, when Jesus would be done with his sermon, you know what he'd say? He'd say, let those that have an ear to hear, let him what? Let him hear what the Spirit is saying. You know, some of you are hearing exactly what I'm saying. Your spirit is going, yep, that's the right thing. Some people, you can preach, says that they're right there. They're hearing the same sermon. They're like, I don't know what he was talking about today. That pastor is so weird. I didn't get anything out of that. All I can do is say, I'm not going to shrink away from telling you the truth. Let's be alive to God this week and dead to sin, and you'll get to move forward and you'll have more abundant life. That's what he wants for you. That's Romans 6 wrapped up. Best way I could present. Now, next week, if you would, read Romans 7, because good old Paul, this is just the... We're just like laying a great foundation. Now we get to build. First, well, I'll call that one of the first walls going up. This alive to God and dead to sin. And then he's going to go, and therefore, you know, Paul, because we got that wall up, now we can start on the next wall. That we're going to build a house for faith that is solid. Okay, by the time we get done with Romans, we'll have it, you know, framed in, roof on top, finished siding, everything. Put the furniture in at the end. I mean, it will be a beautiful house for your faith if you take what these things are, these words, and you say, let that sink in me and work what God wants to work in me, build me the way he wants to. Because does he want to change our lives? Does he want to transform us? Sure. He wants to make us into new creatures that live after him. And it's a beautiful thing Romans teaches us. This is the book. You know, Haley, when he wrote Haley's Bible Handbook, he wrote, this is the book what transforms your life more than any book of the Bible. This book of Romans, only 16 chapters. And Bible chapters are great. They're not like novel chapters. I like Bible chapters. They're like a page, right? You know what I'm talking about? When you read these novels, they got 56 pages in a chapter or something, 110 pages. No, I like Bible chapters, like one page or three quarters of a page. That's a whole chapter in the Bible. This thing's only like 10 pages long, and it'll transform your life. And the truths in this book here can change you from a person stuck in your past to free to live a new life. So let's pray. Let's pray for anyone that's encountering this, and it may be you, but let's pray that the Lord would take that away. Father in heaven, we thank you that we have the privilege to come to you. And we thank you for your word that puts these things in a way that are just practical, easy, Lord. Just tells us, present ourselves living to you. So we do. We begin this week, Lord, as we start off this next week. We like to start off by saying, here we are. Use our lives how you see fit. And we ask that now as we go from here. In Jesus' name, In your son's precious name we pray. And everyone that agreed with me said, amen. Amen. Would you stand with me, listening to a closing song?
Mahalo for joining us. If you'd like more information about us, go to our website, AmazingGraceKona.com, and click the link to follow us on Facebook. That's AmazingGraceKona.com. Mahalo, and God bless.